Good morning, friends. Welcome to our National Economic Survey series, starting off with Chapter 2, dealing with entrepreneurship and wealth creation at the grassroots level. We saw in our last discussion about why wealth creation is so important and how India has traditionally been one of the foremost creators. The discussion is taken forward and how entrepreneurship actually leads to creation of wealth at all levels of society. I would like to thank Subhash for his efforts to get the presentation for us today. Some of the terms: EODB, ease of doing business, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and gross domestic district product. So where we focus on the GDP at the micro district level. So we've got a reasonably comprehensive agenda, starting with India's ranking and how some of the research mechanisms have been done, what is the data which was used, growth in new firms and their consequential improvement in GDP at the district level, creation of wealth at the district level, and similarly, what is the contribution of entrepreneurship to GDP, impact of labor laws on new firm formation, literacy and entrepreneurship, and determinants of entrepreneurship activity. So moving forward, so entrepreneurship, as we all agree, represents a key focus area for many policy makers, given the fact that that would certainly lead to wealth creation and employment generation. The Startup India campaign recognizes that entrepreneurship is one of the important strategies to fuel productivity growth and wealth creation in India. Startups are the main source for creation of new jobs and must be construed as a product of innovation which was not previously in existence, rather than as a stage in a firm's life cycle. So having this in mind, the NES analyzes the position of Indian economy with respect to startup creation, factors contributing to such creation, and the various elements influencing the growth of startups. Again, when we say startups, they are not necessarily restricted to tech-based startups. They are by and large imply businesses which are starting afresh. India's rank in the global arena. So entrepreneurship data, together with that of US, from the US Census Bureau, to compare the total number of new firms in India with that of the cross sections of countries in Asia. So you would notice, friends, so our ranking has not been that great, but we have been growing in the last years to come. We've been growing, and the number of new firm, as we saw in one of the earlier discussions, is roughly about 1,20,000 over the last 4 years, which is definitely a movement in the positive direction. So the growth rate has been at 12.2% in India. And if you notice, US being where it is, they are looking at a much larger base, and which is precisely why the fact that US has been at the forefront of entrepreneurship over the many years. And the scale with which the economy has grown there is a classic testimony to their entrepreneurship. And what is also interesting is you would see places like Israel doing really well, given its size of the economy. Brazil, of course, is now plummeting compared to where they were consequent to various political issues at this point in time. But US definitely at the forefront of all this, and India is definitely doing much better than the past. So the mechanism what was adopted for this survey, so the data is obtained at the district level, GDP at current prices, and the entrepreneurship as a count of new firms in the Ministry of Corporate database, and the data relating to physical and social infrastructure of a district is accumulated from socio-economic high-resolution rural urban geographic data set on India. But what we also need to understand, friends, is the Ministry of Corporate Affairs database only has companies, public or private, and limited liability partnerships. So they don't consider sole proprietary concerns and regular partnership, which by far consists the de facto constitution for startup firms at the initial levels. So there is a survivor bias in the data set, construed as a number of firms which started after 2000 but perished before 2018 could not be tracked, as a result of which the real increase in the number of new not be determined. The data set does not consider the enterprises operating in the informal economy. So that is typically what we said, the entities which does business without registration. So the growth of new firms in India. So between 2014 to 2018, thanks to the Make in India and Startup India initiative, there has been a significant growth in the number of new firms in India. The services sector has been one of the larger drivers of the growth of the new firms. From 2014 and beyond, right from 2006 onwards, the services sector firms have by far outweighed the manufacturing and agriculture and infrastructure space, obviously because the entry barrier in the services sector is far lower than that of a manufacturing or an infrastructure space. Entrepreneurial intensity. So India has very, very low levels of entrepreneurship intensity in the formal economy. In general, the creation of new firms is significantly higher for developed firms. And if you compare the number of new firms per year per 1,000 workers in India, it is 0.1. Of course, we have a very, very large worker base, whereas it is 12.22 and 12.12 in UK and US respectively. So despite having the third largest entrepreneurial ecosystem in the world, there is still a lack of initiative in the economy to start new ventures. So that's a very serious cause for concern, because 0.1 vis-a-vis a 12, we are talking about a 120 time higher base in a developed economy, which by far answers the question of why we have not been able to create good wealth. And the spatial dispersion of entrepreneurship, you would notice Northern India has been leading the way. Western India has also been great. Southern has been sort of moving around, but Eastern India has been grappling, definitely struggling compared to other locations. And this would also give you the space. So the darker red ones are spaces where you have higher density. And given the inability to collect data precisely at Jammu and Kashmir, so that's where it's been undefined at this point in time. So an index of entrepreneurial activity for each district sector is constructed. And for any specific sector, this index is estimated as a district share of new firms in that sector divided by the district share of all new firms across all sectors. And the entrepreneurship capacity of districts in various sectors are a portrayal in which we will be seeing in the subsequent slide. Again, agricultural sector, you would see the peninsular states doing the central and the peninsula, central region being doing the most, peninsular moderate, and even northeastern sectors have also been doing fine. Similarly, the manufacturing space, you would see the western part of India dominating this space, southern being moderate, and the northeastern space being still again moderate in this space. And the pro-employer state regulations are one of the main reasons for new establishment in these states, with the highest regions being Gujarat, Meghalaya, Puducherry, Punjab, and Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, the number of employees required to form a trade union has been increased to 30% of the total workforce, which was only 15%. So very clearly, pro-employer regulations have a very strong impact on growth and entrepreneurial activities, especially in labor-intensive locations. Services sector, you would see that highest entrepreneurial activities happen in the regions of Delhi, Mizoram, Uttar Pradesh, Kerala, Andaman, and Haryana. And the nature of establishments in these happen across diverse spaces, including tourism, hospitality, financial services, retailing. So we are so far used to looking at the southern states like Bengaluru or Chennai or Gurgaon being dominating the tech startup space. But there is a host of other service industries which emanate in this country. And this is definitely a revelation of sorts. Infrastructure space, again, you would see the largest concentration happening in the western, in the northern end, and also to some extent you are northeast and slightly in the mid-eastern space. the states of Jharkhand, Arunachal Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Jammu and Kashmir, Bihar, and some of which are characterized by poor levels of existent infrastructure. So that's also a reason why this has been the growth in infrastructure in these areas have been dense. The correlation between entrepreneurial activity and sectoral unemployment. So very clearly, entrepreneurship activity in agriculture and manufacturing shares a negative correlation with unemployment rate across states. For example, if there is an increase in agricultural land, in the area of agricultural land, which would in turn increase the number of private enterprise and food business and decreases the unemployment rate. So there is a good extent of negative correlation between entrepreneurial activity and unemployment, which is obvious. Contribution of entrepreneurship to GDP, and again, they are very closely correlated and they are very, very positively correlated. So growth in entrepreneurship activity obviously leads to a good growth in the GDP. Effect of labor laws on new firm formation. So this has always been a deterrent, friends. If you notice, the gray areas are states, the gray bars are states with flexible labor laws, and the orange ones are states with inflexible labor laws. And you would see over time, the growth right from 2011 in states with flexible labor laws have been by far much higher than states with inflexible labor laws. Very clearly, labor laws is one of the determinants for employer-friendly jurisdictions. Literacy and entrepreneurship. Again, most of the popular entrepreneurs started from becoming a college dropout. That's the theory by and large. But we need to understand that literacy is not to be linked with knowledge. So here, literacy means the extent to which the ability of a district is able to provide education and which is being utilized by its demographic. The figures here clearly shows that there is a correlation between literacy and the number of new firms formed. So the largest increase in the number of new firms occur only when the literacy rates go above 72%. So that's where the growth in firms also occur. This suggests that small levels of increase matter less and a larger payoff could be attained only when the literacy levels grow beyond a particular threshold of 72%. And similar trend is viewed in the number of colleges as well. As it starts exceeding 26 and beyond, 27 to 52 and 53 and beyond, you would see the growth in the number of firms formed. So there is a very high level of positive correlation between literacy and the number of higher education institutions in a jurisdiction. So what are the determinants for entrepreneurial activities, friends? First, the determinants, we might look at this local demographics, the characteristics of local population, physical connectivity, proximity to large population centers allows startups to expand markets. Technology and finance, which is the ease of access of entrepreneurs to technology and finance, is one of the determinants. Regulatory framework, again, friendlier and employer-centric rules on labor laws definitely increases attraction. And a lower cost of compliance and administration is also one of the reasons where firms tend to concentrate in certain specific jurisdictions. Market access and entrepreneurship. Superior market access is also associated with the higher entrepreneurship. So if you notice, proportion of villages connected by tar roads, if that expands, then the number of firms also increase. Similarly, distance from large population center. So higher the distance, lower the growth of new firms, which is, so again, market access is one of the determinants, significant determinants. So what are we to look at going forward? Consistent with the prevailing wisdom, a significant association between new firms born in a district and the gross domestic district product of the district is found. A 10% increase in new firms is associated with a 1.8% increase in GDP. And measures to increase literacy levels rapidly through institution of more schools and colleges again will spur entrepreneurship. Similarly, better connectivity of villages through tar roads will also increase local market access. And manufacturing sector has the potential to create maximum jobs. States must focus on enabling ease of doing business and implementing flexible labor laws to foster job creation. So these were some of the thoughts which we thought would be relevant to summarize the discussion on this particular topic. We shall catch up again tomorrow on another radio of relevance from on chapter 3 from National Economic Survey. Thank you.